cringing. I'll just be honest with you.
I've never seen anything like it. But listen, I mean, I think that this is boxing. This isn't a 6 foot putt to win the Masters where you have to be so in the moment and mentally and emotionally composed. You've got to go out there and fight. And maybe this newfound Ryan Garcia will help him. Maybe it will help him dig deeper. Maybe it will help him be more aggressive. Or maybe it will make him capitulate on the ninth. But that's the beauty of the sport, that you are exposed in front of the world in the most brutal capacity. And that's what will happen in here on Saturday night. It all gets real. The social media, the rubbish, the screaming, the shouting. You're about to go into war with another man. And you will be exposed on Saturday night if you are not ready.
If you were on the other side of the table, though, and that was your fighter, would you be concerned at all?
Yeah, a lot of people ask me this, you know, would you have pulled him out of the fight? We don't know. We've not had conversations with him. You guys haven't seen him in the gym. But you've got good people around him, like Derek James, like his family, like Golden Boy, where you would hope those guys respect the sport enough to pull him out if they don't think he's ready. So I think he's ready. I actually think it's going to be a very
dangerous
weight fight. That's another story. I actually, when he lifted his top up, I actually think he's going to make weight. I didn't yesterday.
Yeah. Do you feel like he's won a ride the right way with the promotion, though?
Everybody's entitled to do it. I mean, listen, as a promoter, I don't hate it. The only thing I hate maybe is the fact that people maybe believe that he wouldn't make the fight, and that's why now you're seeing it being a late sellout rather than an early sellout.
What were your initial thoughts when he started booing up there?
That's all right. I mean, listen, I've been watching him on social media like a hawk. Haven't we all? I mean, that's why people say, is it good promotion, bad promotion? I've been glued to it. It's been like the Truman Show. Right? Like, you know, you remember that film where it's like, is this actually real? And I don't know whether, and I think that you're seeing uncharacteristic behavior from Ryan Garcia, but then also like him just rolling with it. So some of it I think is like not put on, but extreme. And the other is that he's just maybe out there a little bit, you know? But he looked in good shape.
Eddie, when you came out to the US, this was known as a PBC venue. Mm. It's now become a Golden Boy, the Zone venue. Mm-hmm. Talk to us about sitting at that table here at the Barclays, and can you see potentially matchroom fights taking place here at this venue in New York City?
When we came here, you know, we actually held a fight here many years ago when I came to America and I was promoting for HBO.
Yeah.
And that was Danny Jacobs. Big Baby Miller fought here as well. It was a long time ago. This is a great venue. Great, great venue. And I'm pleased to see Big Time Boxing back here now. And obviously it's open, you know, back in those days. You couldn't get a date, you were blocked from all dates. And now that's not the case, so great to see Big Time Boxing back at Barclays.
And to switch gears a little bit, Tank said, where's the $25 million? Did you promise him $25 million to fight Conor Benn, and are you willing to offer Tank $25 million to fight Devin?
The answer is, I offered Tank Davis $10 million minimum guarantee, plus upside on the gate and the pay-per-view. So probably somewhere between $15 and $20 million to fight Conor Benn. He didn't want to do it, it's fair enough, no problem. I worry about the Devin Haney Tank fight because there's no way Devin Haney would fight under 140 pounds. So Tank would have to be up at 140. And eventually, you know, you asked Devin Haney there about unification fights, etc. I actually see Devin Haney moving to 147 eventually. You know, I mean, he's going to fight. Obviously, he told me off last week because I said I think he'll vacate rather than fight Sandor Martin. He's already given me the instruction to try and make the Sandor Martin fight next because I think he wants to maintain his belts. And I like that. I'd love him to fight Subriel Matias, but in time I see him moving to 47. I mean, who's to say, you know, in time Devin Haney against Boots, that's a fantastic matchup in time. But I would like to see Devin unify or attempt to unify the division at 140 before he moves to 147.
We mentioned 147.
To piggyback on Matias, what's your thoughts on Matias saying he's not interested in fighting Devin Haney, but instead he wants to fight Regis Prograis because Devin is not a big draw and he doesn't sell?
No. What the fight that we need to make is Subriel Matias against Teofimo Lopez.
That's a good one.
That's a serious fucking fight. And also, Subriel Matias against Devin Haney. After he fights Liam Paro, which is a very tough fight, a lot of people writing him off, he should look to unify the division. You guys know, everybody in boxing knows how good Subriel Matias is. He is a bad, bad motherfucker. And if he gets through Paro, I'm going to be looking to make unification matchups for him.
Now, Eddie, you talked about 147. Your biggest signing, obviously, recently has been Jerome Boutenis. Mm. Connor's dealing with Connor issues. Can you provide an update on that? And what is the potential of that happening, a Boots-Connor fight?
Yes, it's there. I'm more interested at the moment. Obviously, he's got Cody Crawley's. He's mandatory. He has to get that out of the way. I would like to make Boots against Stanionis. I would like to make Boots against Barrios as well. I think now there's a good opportunity to make big unification fights for boots, whereas previously there probably wasn't. Crawford, Spence, they all know how good Geron is. And if you can bring the other guys into the mix and pay them well, I think they will fight Geron Ennis. But he'll be out in July, hopefully, bring him home to Philadelphia, and then want to make a big unification matchup for him, ultimately leading to what I think is one of the biggest and best fights in the sport, which is Terence Crawford against Geron Ennis.
What about Conor Benn?
He'll be back. We have to wait on a decision from the board and UCAD. They're all talking at the moment. I think next week, hopefully, you'll have some news on that. I would like Conor to fight Stanionis or Barrios.
Can he fight in the US?
Yes.
So
yes.
That's,
he's not suspended anywhere in the world at the moment.
So he can fight in the Mideast, he can fight in the US, just not in the UK.
We want him. It's been nearly 2 years since the test. So you've seen a lot of other fighters. I don't think he's played it perfectly, but you've seen a lot of other fighters who have got off in 3 and 6 months getting cleared in less of a fashion than he was.
Canelo's trainer, Eddie Reynoso, said that the offer you gave Canelo was disrespectful. That's why he chose
that?
PBC. Eddie Reynoso.
Did he?
Yeah.
Not sure he did, but please send it to me if he did.
Eddie, switching gears a little bit. You just had a really big recent signing, Deontay Wilder. And, you know, I think it took a lot
only
of people
for one night.
Well, you know, let's talk about it. You guys had a lengthy history. He said a lot about you. How does it feel for you to have him now on your team at what I'm sure is a lot less than $100 million you guaranteed him
a few years back? I've always liked Javante. The problem is, in boxing, people get told stuff. People who have agendas will tell fighters certain things, and before they've even met you, they've already decided how they feel about you. And obviously, I said a lot of things about Deontay Wilder because, you know, I was emotional. I was a bit younger. I wanted to make the AJ fight. He said a lot of stuff about me, etc. So this was a situation where His Excellency said, you're allowed to sign someone for the heavyweight wildcard fight in the 5v5. And I wanted to sign what I thought was the best heavyweight available. That's Deontay Wilder. I think he's going to knock Zhang out. And then I think you're going to see him back into the Wilder fight, the AJ fight, etc. So he's a very, very good fighter. If he believes in himself, I think he'll be back with a bang on June 1st.
So let's talk about that, Eddie.
Temperament of Deontay Wilder. Talk to us about the temperament of Deontay Wilder. Yeah. A lot of people question his temperament after the ayahuasca trip that he kind of went on.
Sometimes you have to find yourself. You know, and he went through that process. Everyone's got personal issues they deal with in their life. Some of them you don't know about. But the look that I saw in his eye in London, and when we were talking to His Excellency, was he's back and he's ready to be the old Deontay Wilder. It's one thing saying it. If he can do it, I think he'll knock Zhang out, and I will see.
Is he really your captain in the 5v5?
Absolutely. I've chosen him as my captain. He's the most experienced fighter. He's the most accomplished fighter on the team, and I want him to carry the Matchroom flag and win this tournament.
Who's Warren's captain?
Hamza Shiras.
There you go. Thank you.
What's your thoughts on Canelo saying Al Haymon is the best promoter?
Who's that?
So what's your thoughts on Al Haymon? I mean, Canelo saying Al Haymon is the best promoter.
Whoever he's working with at the time, he says he's the best promoter in the world.
Eddie, it's got to feel good though, right? Having Deontay on the team after all that, has got to feel a little good.
I've got Deontay on the team. I've got Devin on the team. I've got Boots on the team.
There you go.
I mean, I go to this guy.